This is the December 18th, 2014 matchup between the Edmonton Oilers and the San Jose Sharks. I'll be analyzing the highlights as an exercise for myself, but I figured I'd, you know, post it on the internet and let you guys tag along if anyone's interested. Once again, my cursor isn't showing up, so I'm going to have to use this kind of shitty highlighting program to show you guys anything that I won't be able to explain on the screen. Sorry about that in advance. So let's get started. This first highlight, we're going to have an Edmonton zone entry. I don't think it's a goal, but here we go. You can see the standard zone entry play there with the anchor on the boards. This player with the puck right now, open up this shitty highlight thing, he's going to leave the puck for this guy on the boards, the anchor, who's just going to take it into the boards and sit here, while these players are going to kind of come into the zone and, you know, be threatening and menacing in order to drive these defensemen away from him and create space. This player is going to enter the zone wide with a little bit of speed and receive the cross-ice pass. This defenseman, I think that's a defenseman. Usually it's a defenseman entering the zone with speed to get the pass, and then he's just going to take a shot on net. So that's a standard zone entry play that you're going to see a lot in today's NHL. A lot, especially on power plays. And there we go. That's going to be the first play of the night. I do apologize for the skips in footage, like the one you probably just noticed. I'm not quite good enough to analyze it live yet, so I've got to take a quick look at the play. So I'm not wasting your guys' time. Anyways, in this case, there are a few things I want to point out. Generally, not too much. First of all, if you look in front of the net right now, the San Jose player in black is getting inside position on the net. This is something that happened all game long throughout these entire scene of highlights that I noticed. Both of these teams really like to get inside position on the net, and both of them seem pretty weak in front of the net, unable to push the opposition out from the inside position. This defenseman really needs to get that guy out of there, get inside position on the net, and I don't think he's going to do that all night long. So let's go first. Another thing here, as you can see, this player right wide open in the front of the net here. Let me open the shitty highlight tool. Is it even working? Who knows? My shitty highlight tool isn't even working anymore. damn it. Anyways, this guy in front of the net here. Wait for it. Wait for it. Goddamn shitty recording material. Alright, the guy standing, basically the guy that's uncovered. Hopefully you can see the guy in black that's uncovered standing right in the slot. The guy who's supposed to be covering him is obviously way too high, and he's above him, and if he gets the puck right now, he's going to be in a wide open position, just walk in and shoot. He does get the pass, he's not able to corral it, though, but if he had been able to control that pass, it would have been a dangerous situation. Cannot give up position. Defenders generally should always be between the man they're covering and the net. That was just bad defensive coverage. Now this time, the guy that's covering him is way too low, so someone's got some issues here that they're going to be talking to their coach about defensively. Anyways, get the shot on net, and it actually creates a decent opportunity because, like I said before, these San Jose players had inside position on the net, and that's something that's going to be recurring a lot throughout these highlights. So in this next clip, the puck's going to squirt out to the corner. Edmonton's going to put on a strong check there and create a turnover. It's a nice play. Now, these players are going to force a switch here. Now, I want you to watch a few things that my highlight tool probably won't work again. Oh, it worked! Yes, alright, number 10 here. He's going to take the puck, and he's going to move down low, which is going to create a 2-on-1 against this defender. Meanwhile, this guy is going to squirt up high into the slot and kind of lose the defenseman, because I think this guy is actually going to decide to help out down low instead, forcing a switch. Now, also notice this defenseman in front of the net. He's going to get away from his position, get poor defensive position, and he's going to try and come out and help in the corner as well, which is going to leave this guy wide open in front of the net. As you can see, he squirts around. All three of them decide to go down and help out in the corner, kind of, and they just leave this guy wide open for the pass and the one-timer. And he also does a good job, the eventual shooter does a good job of getting into the seam, which is these areas right here and right here. Those are called the offensive seams, and they're very difficult to defend, and generally the high guy should usually be playing in those seams. He does a good job getting there. This next play, excuse me, this next play is just really poor defensive coverage. Edmonton's going to kind of throw it into the zone here. They're going to battle for it in the corner. Now, look at this defensive coverage. We've got three guys down low. Again, this defenseman who should be playing in front of the net is cheating down low. So we've got three guys in the corner. This player right here is on the wall when really he should be playing closer to the dots on the inside, since you can't see it because of my shitty highlight tool, but the Edmonton player is right there on the boards. And eventually what's going to happen is the puck's going to squirt out here. He's just going to walk to the center, beating all these guys out, and it's going to be basically a 1-on-0. This guy is going to try to get back, but this guy can't really step in, because if he does, this defenseman up in the corner here is just going to step in and receive the pass, so it's kind of a 2-on-1 against this guy. Now let's watch that play out. As you can see, bad defensive position by him. He gets beat to the center, and they just... probably shouldn't have been a goal, but they get a good opportunity. If he had been a left-handed shooter, that would have been better. Looks like they got a little replay of it here, too, so you can see it again for your viewing pleasure. Next, we have a similar zone entry to what we saw in the first highlight of the night. It's kind of a broken anchor play. As you can see, this guy's on the boards. We got a guy on the boards on each side, and now the centerman kind of carrying up with the puck, although he kind of loses it there. Eventually does get it to the guy on boards. And you can see how it's similar to the play that would have happened before with the anchor on the boards, except this time he's kind of deeper in the zone, which opens up room. It's kind of a little, it's really a broken play, but I mean, they managed to come through with it and just get the shot on net, and Edmonton does a pretty good job boxing them out in this instance, so it's not going to be a goal. Here we have just a really dumb play. It's kind of a waste of time to analyze it, but I'll just let you see it. Just watch it for the hell of it. I just skipped the last highlight since there was nothing really to see. It was just a face-off win that ended up in a shot and a little bit of a scramble. So, nothing really there. Now, in this case, it's going to be a nice, really nice play by San Jose's kind of grinded-out AHL call-up line. First, we see 1-4 switch as this player enters the net from the other side, crosses behind the net to get the puck. This forces the first switch in defensive coverage as the guy who was originally covering him is the defenseman in front of the net. So now it's going to be number 5, the other defenseman, following him into the corner. Beats him around, forces another switch as this guy comes in to check him. That opens up all sorts of space. He's just going to throw it behind the net for this guy to pick up now. Forces another switch as he goes just far enough behind the net to force 5 to come down and cover him. So now he's got two guys down behind the net covering him, which is going to leave somebody open. He finds a 15 in front of the net for the goal there. So lots of force switching there from, I believe that's the 4th San Jose line, all AHL call-ups, so pretty cool. A lot to see on this play as well. First of all, we're going to see this player right up there, the furthest forward black player. Goddamn, my shitty highlight thing. This player right here is going to skate hard into the zone, and he's going to create the false gap by forcing these defensemen to respect that and backing off. And then we're going to see another player, I'm not sure which one it is, one of these players is going to come up and generate a little bit of speed behind the puck here, and he's going to receive a pass across the ice there. So first of all, let's look at the false gap. Look at how much space this creates for the play in the zone here as the defensemen are forced to back off. He's going to get this pass across the ice. Now we're going to see him cut a little bit towards the open side, and look at him with his head up. He sees that all of these Edmonton players they've all turned their skates and are heading in his direction, which is going to leave the other side of the net of the ice wide open. So he's going to pass back across. I believe that's Couture. Does a great job catching that puck in stride. Normally you could see, let's back up a little bit here. Back up. You can see on that zone entry we have the makings of another anchor play, with this guy up on the boards and him entering the zone with speed, but in this case he's already got this defenseman beat, so he just decides to walk in and shoot, and he ends up with the goal. So lots of big plays. Notice a lot of times what they're going to show in the highlights is just him getting the puck on the blue line there and shooting, probably. And you know, what made that goal is really what happened in the neutral zone. That was a great pass to him as well. And that was really probably the best assist of this game that I saw. This was a really interesting game in that a lot of the goals were scored by kind of the grinded out lines, and I think there were or like AHL call up guys. I think someone even scored their first NHL goal in this game, so pretty interesting in that. Now in this case, here, let me rewind this a little bit so you can see. What I want you to pay attention to is these two Edmonton players and the guys that are covering them. Both these Edmonton players, early on in the attack, they're going to work hard to get body position or inside position on the net on their defenders. So that's what's going to eventually create this goal, is that inside position is going to create a two-on-one between these two Edmonton players and this defenseman in front of the net. You can see this Edmonton player on the far boards has bad position on his check right now, but he's going to keep working hard. And now you can see that both Edmonton players have body position on their checks. So this guy's just going to throw the puck in front, and that's what's going to create the two-on-one here, and the scramble in front of the net, and eventually they're going to score, because they're unable to box. I mean, the one defenseman is unable to box both of them out. So that's a great play. A couple things to see in this play as well. The puck's going to go into the corner here. Nice keep-in. Now, we're going to see, I believe this is Eberle. We have Eberle and with the puck right now, and Nugent Hopkins in front of the net. I want to watch these two guys. Eberle is going to get the puck, and immediately the first thing he's going to do as soon as he can is get off the boards. And I'm not sure exactly what happened with this defenseman that was covering him, but he somehow screws up. I really don't know. Maybe it was a little head fake by Eberle or something like that, but he screws up, which creates more space for Eberle. Space that was created just by doing a simple good play, getting off the boards immediately and creating good position on this defender where he has a lot of deceptive options. Now we're going to see this defenseman is stepping up on Eberle in front to kind of cut down that option. And Eberle is going to use a soft shoulder and just roll or spin off the check to get body position in front of the net. And that's what's going to create the goal in the end, as Eberle is just going to a nice shot on net, which creates a rebound. And since Nugent Hopkins did that nice shoulder roll off the check to get body position, no one's going to be able to defend him as he gets that rebound and shoves it in. Again, I'm going to skip another play here as nothing really happened worth analyzing. Going ahead here, we have this nice play. Now, I want you to watch this player on the far boards, on the far wing side, this guy right here. Previously, he was down low. He shifted up here into this position, and eventually what he's going to do is force a two-on-one with this defender. His defenseman that's up here past the shitty white line on my shitty highlight device. He's somewhere up there. He gets the puck. He's going to come up high, kind of like he would on a power play, forcing a two-on-one with this Edmonton player. He's going to get the pass. Now, what I would like to see here is this. I'm not going to be able to see it, but this defensive player that we can't see past my shitty white line, I'd like to see him step up on the play here, recognize that this is a two-on-one, and just explode down into here. Instead, he just stays up high, and it doesn't work out. Although I would like to watch it one more time, though it could have been better if the defenseman had stepped into the play, it did still create space. You can see he kind of forced the switch here, the man who now has the puck, by coming so high up the boards. His man down low didn't want to come that high to cover him, so he forced the switch here, and made it a two-on-one, so we have Eberle now jumping away from his defenseman to cover the man who is basically uncovered, and in doing so, he's leaving another man basically uncovered. So it did create space for him to, you know, make the play at his leisure, but it could have been a lot better play if he'd stepped up. Again, I'm going to skip another play in here, because it was just created by horrendous Edmonton defense, and I don't need to subject you guys to that. So, in this play here, we're going to have this pass across to Perron, who's on the point for some reason. And now, what I want you to notice... damn it. This highlight thing. There's a defenseman here. An Edmonton defenseman. And we're going to have Perron just kind of walk past. I don't know what this guy is doing. I have no clue what that guy's doing, but Perron's just going to walk past him. Like, he's a winger playing defense against an offensive guy. I'll give him a break. Braun's just going to walk past him, and look at all of these players. No one is watching this defenseman. And look how high he stays, all the way up at the blue line. If he had just walked up here and gotten into the play, well, I'll just let you use your imagination and see what this play could have become if he had done that. Look how wide open he would have been. No one was even looking up high. No one knows where that defenseman is. He could be right here, get that pass, and have a perfect shot. But instead, again, these defensemen are just failing to step up into the play, and that's resulting in a loss of a lot of scoring opportunities. It's a very important skill for defensemen to learn when they should step up into the play and contribute to the offense. Now, in this one, I remember already watching this, so I can go straight into it. This is going to be the first goal of this player right here is going to eventually score it. He's coming out from behind the net, kind of with speed. He's going to score his first NHL goal here, and it's basically a false gap and speed behind the puck, and that's all that it is. Notice that he's going to skate hard down the ice and never slow down. He's going to get the pass in stride, and he's going to basically blow past a bunch of slow-moving defenders towards the front of the net. Although he could have gained more speed, you'll see that he uses straight strides here and never really crosses over. If he had been crossing over and using a better skating pattern, I think he could have gained even more speed and really beaten this defenseman. He could have beaten him to the net if he'd done that. But anyways, he does get the shot off, and he scores his first goal. Let's watch that one more time. You can see these players coming back. They were further down the ice, kind of in a loop formation or whatever. They were out there setting a gap. So look at, eventually it's going to be this defenseman here, I believe, versus this player who's going to score the goal. And look at this huge gap that he has to work with right now. So he has all that room to build speed, and he's going to do exactly that. Now look how much faster he's going than the defenseman he's eventually going against, him versus him. He loses some speed there, as I think he kind of hesitates as he sees this guy coming towards him, but if he'd kept up his speed and maybe used some crossovers, he could have easily taken net front there and gotten a breakaway, I think. But he does score the goal, so credit to him. First NHL goal, congratulations. Unfortunately, I don't recall his name right now, but there you have it. We cut out the last play again because we couldn't see enough of the ice to really figure out how it happened and analyze it, so nothing I could really do there. It was a breakaway pass that resulted in a San Jose goal, so now they're up 4-3. The beginning of this play is difficult to analyze, too, because it already looks a little bit broken. So I'm not sure, and this is where the clip starts, doesn't start any earlier. So I can't really tell what led to this situation. Anyways, I can't really say anything about this since I don't know how it happened. But what happens afterward, there's lots to learn from. So this puck goes into the corner, and you can see the defenseman stepping up into the play in order to keep the play alive, really. He's the closest to the puck, so he's going to do it. And we're going to see, I believe that's, I want to say, gosh, probably going to make a fool of myself, but I want to say it's Pavelski. It's number 8. On San Jose, I really don't know, but he's going to be taking the place of the defenseman, and I want you to keep that in mind. This guy is a forward playing defense, so he's going to be offensively minded. He's going to get the play. First good play we're going to see here is he's going to get the puck, skate with the puck instead of stopping with it there. So he's going to create, by skating with the puck, he's going to create more space for himself. Let me open up my shitty highlight thing. Instead of just stopping there, he's going to continue skating around that way with the puck and pick it up, which is going to create, he's going to be coming off the boards with a little bit of momentum, which is going to force these guys to respect him. He's not going to be able to be pinned up against the boards like that. And also, he's going to be creating space between him and the guy that's actually going to be checking him. So that's the first good play we see him make. He steps off the boards. That's the second good play, which creates a lot more deceptive options. Now, when we have right here, we have pretty good coverage. He's covered by him. He's covered by him. He's covered by him, covered. For the most part, Edmonton has decent coverage, and they all have position between their man and the net, which is good. You can see the guy behind the net, though, the San Jose player, kind of hiding from coverage, creating a lot of space between him and his man by hiding behind the net, and that's eventually what we're going to want to see. The pass is going to go down here to, I believe it's Hurdle. Yeah, I think that's Hurdle, who is going to... You can see the guy who was behind the net is now coming towards this direction, trying to create a two-on-one. And you can see that this other player on the boards over here has beaten his guy to the inside and now has inside position on his defender. So we're going to see this pass go down low, and this is a two-on-one right here. This is a two-on-one net front between these two players and the goaltender. And the goaltender too, but this defender in front of the net. But they're not going to use that 2-on-1. That's just the first opportunity I wanted to point out. And you can see that this switch, kind of a little bit of a force hesitation switch there by this guy coming into... It used to be this player was over here. So this was one defensive coverage zone, this was another defensive coverage zone. This player came from behind the net in that defensive coverage zone into this one, which kind of forced a little bit of a switch decision, and that's how they got this much space. He created this much space between himself and this defenseman who was on him before. So he now has a puck with a lot of space, and you can see I believe it's Pavelski. This is that offensive defenseman again that I was mentioning before, stepping in to the play, actually at a good opportunity, and he creates another option for this shot. Ends up in a good chance, doesn't complete in this case, but I think that was a really good play that we can learn a lot from, and I'm just going to play it again so you can kind of watch it live and see it, since I think that was a really good one. So we have defenseman walking in, going to pass it back high, got this offenseman up high, comes off the boards, makes the play across, kind of a little bit force switch there, creates a gap between the defenders. Defenseman walks into the play there. He's actually forward on defense, but if it was a defenseman, this is a play I'd like to see. More aggressive defensive, offensive defensive play. Walks in to that gap there to create another option, and he is eventually used and gets the shot off. So that was a great play. So here we have, this is end of the game, empty net, as you can see in the top left corner. It's a 6-on-5 situation, and here, I think I started too late to really see the full thing, so let me rewind here. We can see this player in the corner with the puck now. I think that's Everly. So he's going to pass it up, and he's going to follow the play around, kind of. And he's going to, well the next thing I want to see is that these Edmonton players getting net front position, and there's nothing that the San Jose players can really do, or they don't even try in this case, it seems like, but... I mean, since they're outnumbered, they can't really prevent the net front position. So we're going to see Eberle kind of come higher. Personally, I'd like to see him come a little bit higher and, clearly decide for himself who's going to be covering him. But he comes up here kind of in the middle, which is just high enough so that this guy doesn't really see him as his man. He's going down here. So he's making... let me clear this stuff. Eberle, when he comes up here, he's deciding that this is going to be the man that's covering him. And he's getting inside position already on him. So we're going to see Kim come up here. He's got inside position on his man, I guess. I don't really like analyzing power play situations since, you know, it's an odd man thing and it kind of throws everything off. But in this case, that was a good play. I'd like to see him come a little higher since he would have all that space. But in this situation, this guy decides to come in and play him instead, which is going to leave Eberle wide open in the slot for the pass and a shot. And then, as you could see, the net front position that Edmonton had allows this player to get another rebound and another chance there. Well, it doesn't quite complete. And I think that's going to be the end of it. This is going to be the end of the game. So let me know what you think. If you agree, disagree, see anything that I don't. And thanks for watching.